I'm walking through here. Look at this fat guy. Yeah, he doesn't know what's coming. And there we go. We got this beautiful machine right here. It took me 15 years and 7 hours to make, but it's finally. Uh oh. Now that that's over, time to show you what my masterpiece can do. Yeah! See you in hell! After what seems like forever, the sequel to The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild has finally been released. And oh my god! The Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom is a direct sequel to one of the most innovative open world games of all time. And a lot of people going into this were very worried about how they could expand on one of the most innovative and most free open world games of all time. It was going to be a challenge to make a game that was just as innovative and just as free. So what was Nintendo's answer to this problem? Let's just make Gmod. I kid you not. Let me explain. Breath of the Wild was kept alive for what, 6 years? Just from all the new ways people found to play the game and break the game. Imagine the amount of content that this game would provide for what, 10 years. Ultra Hand and Fuse alone are technical marvels. Ultra Hand lets you pick up virtually anything. It's like a buffed up Magnesis, and it lets you attach it to virtually anything. This is where the Gmod shenanigans come in, okay? Because you can build basically anything you want. A plane, a car, the Green Goblin Mobile, a fighter jet, a tank, a fighting mech, a multi-stage rocket. It's practically endless. The systems that were made here to, it probably took years to finally get right. Fuse as well. You can attach anything to your weapon. This thing, that thing, whatever the hell that is. And the genius of it is that it kind of fixes the problem with weapon durability. In Breath of the Wild, you wouldn't want to use your good weapons because you feared them breaking. So you would keep them and not use them. But in Tears of the Kingdom, nearly every weapon in the game has a low base damage stat. So it encourages you, and it's kind of required, to use Fuse to your weapons to see what different combinations work to see how high of a damage multiplier you can get. And some weapons even have different status elements, like the Zora sword being more damage when it's wet, or the Gerudo sword doing more damage when fused to items. Then we get to the other abilities. I see a lot of people saying Ascend is really situational, but I found myself using it quite a lot. It makes climbing things much easier, and I'm constantly using it. I find Recall a bit more situational, actually. I'm only using it in certain combat encounters and during platforming, but regardless, it's still a very useful ability. And finally, auto build, which lets you save builds that you've made, and in exchange, it auto builds them for some Zonite. These four abilities already blow the OG4 out of the water. It makes this game feel so much more free, and it lets you do whatever you, oh my god, so much better than what we had before. Now, another problem that was needed addressing was, how are they gonna make Hyrule not exactly the same? Because you can't just put this exact same Hyrule and people be happy with it. Well, for starters, there's Sky Islands now. Right off the bat, replacing the Great Plateau is the Great Sky Islands, which serves us the same purpose. It feels a bit more linear though. It's clear that there is a way for you to go through it, but it's still a great first tutorial. And it's huge, it's a really big island. I was surprised, genuinely. So I hope that you enjoy it, because that's the biggest island you're gonna get in the game. Yeah, the best way to describe the sky would be comparing it to the Great Sea in Wind Waker. It's a lot of sky you have to traverse, with a few islands spotted here and there, and they host either a shrine or a gambling machine. Gambling! I love gambling! There are also islands that host mini-games that let you obtain exclusive items. One thing I kinda don't like a lot about these islands is they kind of all look the same, they kind of all blend in with each other. And it suffers from the problem of them all looking kind of the same. But I do enjoy the shrine puzzles a lot. Basically, you have this green stone and you have to get it to a shrine location, and it's up to you how to get it there. And there are a few other islands that do have distinct looks. And again, it's like Wind Waker, where you have those important islands and you have those smaller islands. Then we get to Hyrule. A lot has changed. The Typhoon ruins aren't covered in darkness anymore. A lot of towns and landmarks have been changed. New areas have been added. A lot of Hyrule has been changed to make you feel like you're not just running around the same place anymore. The first thing that I did was go back to the Great Plateau to see what changed. And I'm not going to spoil it here, but I was very happy with what I found. And if a new Sky Island and altered Hyrule ain't enough for you, well, you still have... Oh. I'm in hell now, I guess. The depths. A whole other world. Not just a few areas scattered around. An entire world, the same size as Hyrule, completely underground. We thought there was just gonna be some caves and stuff, not the entirety of hell. When I first got here, I nearly shat my pants, okay? It's pitch black. They're these demonic versions of overworld enemies, okay? It's quite literally hell. I don't want to spoil it for you because you kind of have to experience it for yourself, but it is a treat. And I haven't even finished exploring half of it yet. And another thing I want to throw in is there's shrines again. They are. But they feel different from the shrines in Breath of the Wild. I don't know how to really put it, but the puzzles in there feel more like traditional Zelda puzzles rather than like, oh, you got to do this and like use yours. It's like... I feel like you can, like, the dungeons in Breath of the Wild, they feel like you have to use this specific ability and do this specific thing. But in these dungeons, it feels like there's more than one way to solve the puzzle, and I really do like that. Now, I want to get into some story and world building. Past this point, all spoilers are fair game, so be prepared. So, this game definitely feels more like a traditional Zelda game. The story has a much bigger focus than it did in Breath of the Wild. There are traditional dungeons, which may I add, are drastic improvements from the Divine Beasts. They reintroduce Ganondorf, who as an actual character, instead of Calamity Ganon, who's just a fucking blob of darkness. I feel like that really adds to the story. A lot of things in this game make it feel like a traditional Zelda game. Except for something that I still don't understand. The Triforce seems to have absolutely no significance in this game. At least in Breath of the Wild, it had some relevance, but here it's basically like not even in the story at all, right? And some people are like, oh, you don't need the Triforce and all that. And like, I kind of get it. Instead of the Triforce, Ganon's looking for the stone. But even in like Ocarina of Time, where basically it's the same premise where you have to get all the 6 stages and their medallions, the Triforce was still very important. Because it's literally the Triforce is the most powerful item in the entire Zelda universe, okay? It's literally a triangle made by gods. And I'm just kind of baffled that it's not even, like, in this game at all. It's not even mentioned. So, that kind of bothered me. I don't know why. The way that the story is told in this game is much similar to Breath of the Wild with memories. But in this game, they were, first of all, much easier to find. And the way that they're told is much more interesting, and I find myself way more invested, because even though it's technically the past, we're still just seeing Zelda's side of the story. And after completing all of the tiers, I was just like, why you do this to me? Why did you do it? Yeah, the story in this game is dark. It is much darker than Breath of the Wild. When I saw Ganon make that face, I was like, what the fuck? No, Ganon. This is not funny. This is not a funny moment, okay? This is a serious time. Besides the memory, the story you experience as Link also feels much better, because it's not about things that already happened. Like, oh, you have to like fix this divine beast that's been destroyed for 100 years. It's about things that are happening right now. The story feels way more proactive, and I really like it. And I feel more invested because it's about things that I have to fix now and are happening right now. But, oh my, Link. Oh my god, Link. Listen, Link. I love you, man. You're the G. But I have a problem with him being kind of emotionless Listen, I had a problem with him being emotionless in Breath of the Wild, right? And I know there's an explanation like, oh, he has to bear the burden and all that shit. And I understand that's why he doesn't talk and why he's super serious. But for God's sake, like, at least in Breath of the Wild, he had some emotion, okay? Like, look at this scene where Zelda is crying, right? Look at his face. See? He is upset. He looks concerned and upset. If this scene happened in Tears of the Kingdom, he would be looking like this. Listen, I'm not asking for like fucking Toon Link expressions. Like, I'm not asking him to pull a bitch face or some fucking cartoon shit. But I'm asking him to have a fucking personality. Like, come on. Like, in Skyward Sword or Twilight Princess, he didn't talk in those games, but at least he wasn't a robot. He didn't react to anything like I feel like he should. And it kind of took me out of the story. And people say, oh, but it's he's a knight. He's not supposed to be, like, showing emotions. Okay, but like, there's moments, like, for example, when the when he watched all the memories, all he did was be like, oh, what did I just see? Like, he didn't fucking, like, I was expecting him at the, like, the last memory to be like, what the fuck did I just see? And, like, have, like, some type of emotion, right? Now, this shit really got me. At the end of the game, Link finally saves Zelda. Blank stare. Like, bro, that is your GF, bro. That is your wife, I think. That is your GF, and you should be, like fucking stone-faced. It takes me out of the story, because it feels like he should be reacting more. He shouldn't just be a fucking blank stare at everything, at the most serious things and like the most shocking revelations. I feel like he should have some emotion. All right, so now we got all that stuff in. Now the performance. This game should fucking run on Switch. This game, I was talking about the Master Hand and the Ultra Hand and the Fuse being a technical marvel. This game in general is a technical marvel. It is shocking to me that this game has three separate layers, right, of world. You can just seamlessly go into the sky or seamlessly go to the underground. No loading screens or anything. The game runs decent on the Switch and it's only 16 gigabytes. Call of Duty needs at least 200 gigabytes to be on my PlayStation. And this game is a full, like, one of the best games I've played in my life is on 16 gigabytes. There are some stuttering. There are some times where it dips really low in the frame rate. But personally, I don't care. The art style carries this game's graphics. The graphics aren't even that bad. This game already looks better than Breath of the Wild. I already know that. I'm just fucking baffled. I don't know what Nintendo did. And I know what they, in an interview, they said they basically, like, when they delayed the game was already done, right? They just took that extra year to polish the game. That's probably where that all happened, bro. So, this game is crazy. Absolutely crazy. But overall, this game did the impossible. It improved on nearly everything that Breath of the Wild did, and I'm pretty sure you've heard this a lot. This game makes Breath of the Wild look like a tech demo, and it's gonna be really hard to go back to Breath of the Wild after TOTK. And that makes me think, what is next? What is next for Nintendo? They said that this style of game is gonna be what the future for Zelda. How are they gonna improve on this? They already made one of the best games of all time, no question. I don't think it's going to be similar to what to other games, like it comes out, oh, this is so good, and people are going to switch up on it. This is genuinely one of the greatest games ever made. Sure, it's still the honeymoon phase. Eventually, there's going to be some stuff that, you know, people point out and say, oh, this game's not super perfect. There are some things here and there. For example, the menu scrolling is sometimes annoying with the fuse. It can get annoying sometimes. But overall, this game is almost nearly perfect. For me, this is probably going to be my game of the year. Unless...